Hello learners, welcome to NIOS. I am Dr. Sonali Singh from RiseNext College of Education. Today we will discuss about the biology course at senior secondary level in which we will study or discuss about your kingdom Plantae and kingdom Animalia. Now, first we will study about kingdom Plantae. What are plants? Plants are multicellular eukaryotic photosynthetic autotrophs. Multicellular means made up of various types of cells. And the word eukaryotic means an organism whose cells contain a nucleus surrounded by a membrane and whose DNA is bound together by proteins into chromosomes. The cells of eukaryotes also contain an endoplasmic reticulum and numerous specialized organelles not present in prokaryotes, especially mitochondria, Golgi bodies, etc. Autotrophs or producers, as we generally call, is an organism that produces complex organic compounds such as carbohydrates, fats, and proteins from simple substances present in its surroundings, generally using energy from light. Now, this whole process is called as photosynthesis. Now, your kingdom Plantae is classified into following divisions. First, bryophyta, second, pteridophyta, and the third is spermatophyta. The first one, bryophyta, are also called as amphibians of plant kingdoms and are non-vascular, that is, they don't have xylem and phloem. On the other hand, pteridophyta have true roots, stem and leaves, and vascular tissue is present, that is, they have xylem and phloem as conductive tissues. Moving on to the third one, spermatophyta, they are your seed-producing plants and vascular tissues are present inside them. These spermatophyta are further divided into gymnospermy as well as angiospermy. Now, what are gymnosperms? Gymnosperms are naked seeded plants in which the seeds are not enclosed in an ovary. Whereas on the other side, angiosperms have the seeds which are enclosed in the ovary wall. They are further divided into two parts, dicotyledons, and the second part is monocotyledons. Dicotyledons means it consists of embryo with two cotyledons, and monocotyledon has a single cotyledon in the embryo. Now we will discuss about all these parts one by one in detail. The first one that comes to be in front of you is visible is bryophyta or bryophytes. Bryophytes are also called as amphibians of plant kingdom because though they live in soil, still they need water for sexual reproduction. As you know, we have frogs and all those which we term as amphibians. Why? Because they live in soil as well as they need water for their survival. So these bryophytes are also called as amphibians of your plant kingdom. The sperms of these bryophytes are flagellate and need water to swim to the eggs. They are the embryophytes that do not have their own vascular tissues, means that they don't have xylem for phloem as a conducting tissues. Whereas multicellular sporophytes are always born on the gametophyte. Bryophytes have no true leaves and roots as their independent body is gametophytic or haploid. Now, what is haploid? A haploid is a cell or organism that has a single set of chromosomes that are not paired. The haploid gamete is normally produced during plant cell division and it has only half the number of chromosomes as in diploid. In bryophytes, the sex organs are jacketed as they are always surrounded by one or several layers of sterile cells. There are three main types of bryophytes. Now, from the figure, it is very clear that this is the thallus shape of bryophyte. Male and female part of liverwort is visible to you, which is a part of your bryophyte. Now, the first is flat ribbon-like liverworts. The second one is a small, leafy, plant-like body that is your mosses or funaria. Now, the flat ribbon-like bryophyte is your liverwort. The second one is a small, leafy, plant body that is your mosses or we can call it as funaria also. The third one is flat, thalloid, undifferentiated vegetative tissue plant body bearing a horn-like sporophyte is the diploid multicellular stage in the life cycle of a plant or an alga. It develops from the zygote produced when a haploid egg cell is fertilized by haploid sperm And each sporophyte has a double set of chromosomes, one set from each parent. Example is hornwort or anthoceros. In all these types of bryophytes, the main plant body is a gametophyte, larger and more persistent and photosynthetically active that bears the sex organs. In mosses, as the case of example is, the gametophytic plant body is a leafy system called gametophore, but in liverworts or hornworts, the plant body is usually a thallus, which was already shown to you in a figure, having different types of male thallus as well as female thallus. It's a ribbon-like or heart-shaped and bilaterally symmetrical structure. The body is without roots, stems, and leaves. The plants are anchored to the soil by rhizoids, which are unicellular in liverworts and hornworts and multicellular in mosses. The male sex organs are antheridia and female sex organs are called as archegonia. The gametes are produced in the sex organs. Male and female gametes fuse to give rise to a zygote, which develops into a sporophyte. This sporophyte remains attached to the gametophyte and depends on it for foods and mineral. The sporogenous tissue in the sporophyte undergoes meiosis. It's the type of cell division that results in four daughter cells, each with the half number of chromosomes of the parent cell, as in the production of gametes and plant spores, to produce haploid spores. The spores on dispersal germinate to give rise to a gametophyte again. Now, what is a gametophyte? This undergoes mitosis. That is your gamete producing phase of the plant. Whereas your sporophyte always undergoes meiosis and produces spores. This can be termed as spore producing phase of plants. The bryophytes are the pioneers of the vegetation. That is, they are the first one to grow on various habitats like rock, lava, sand, water, and they act as soil binders. Now, when we come on to the comparison of these two phases, your gametophytic phase and sporophytic phase, then your gametophytic phase is haploid phase, generally autotrophic. It produces gametes, and these gametes are produced by mitosis. Whereas in your sporophytic phase, this is a diploid phase, heterotrophic or partially autotrophic. It always produces spores, as from the word sporophytic, it is very clear, and these spores are produced by meiosis. So main difference that comes out in these two phases is the process of division, that is mitosis and meiosis. Now we move on to the next part of the plant kingdom, that is your pteridophyta or pteridophytes. Pteridophytes are fern plant. Ferns are lower vascular plants. They contain vascular tissues, which is made up of xylem and phloem and helps in conduction of water and nutrients to all parts of the plant body. Learners, you know that xylem is responsible for the conduction of water and phloem is responsible for the conduction of nutrients to the various parts of the plant body. The main plant body represents a sporophytic, that is diploid. It means cells containing two sets of chromosomes, one from each parent generation, and has roots which penetrate the soil to absorb water and minerals. The leaves, or we can call fronds, in the case of pteridophytes, of this sporophyte grow on thick horizontal underground stem or rhizome, which bears adventitious roots. The young leaves and the bases of fronds are covered by dry brown scales that is called as ramenta. The young leaves and leaflets are succinctly coiled structures. The excess of the leaves is called as rachis, and the leaflets on both sides of rachis are called pinnae. The division of pinnae are known as pinnules. On the undersurface of the leaves, there develops a spore-producing body called sporangia in groups, or you can call it as a sori. In singular, we can say it or pronounce it as sorus, which may or may not be covered by multicellular structure called indusium. This sporogenous tissue in the sporangia undergoes meiosis to produce haploid spores. These spores on dispersal germinate into an independent small thallus-like body, the gametophyte, called as prothallus. Now, this is the prothallus that bears your male and female gametes. The male gametes are termed as enthridia and female gametes are called as archegonia. The gametes fuse and zygote develops into a diploid sporophyte. The young embryo absorbs nutrients and water from the gametophyte until its roots and leaves are formed. This gametophyte then dies out. Gametophyte grows independent of sporophyte. Both have their own identities. But it lives for a very short period of time, and a new sporophyte is temporarily dependent upon a tiny gametophyte. Now we move on to the next part of the plant kingdom, that is your gymnosperms. Gymnosperm is derived from the word gymnos and sperms. Gymnos means naked and sperma or spermi means seed. So the plants which have the naked seeds. Now the gymnospermi bear naked ovules on the flat scale leaves called oviliferous scales, which are not enclosed in carpels or ovary. The oviliferous scales are arranged in the form of cones. These are termed as their fruits. Now we will discuss the characteristics of gymnosperms. The adult plant, or called sporophyte, is a tall woody perennial tree or shrub, mostly evergreen. The stem is usually branched, but sometimes, as in the case of cycas, it remains unbranched. Leaves may be simple, as in the case of pinus, or leaves could be compound, as in the case of cycas. Leaves may be dimorphic or of one kind only. Foliage leaves are large, green, simple, or pinnately compound, needle-like, and grow on dwarf shoot, as in the case of pinus, or they are directly borne on the main trunk, as in case of cycas. Scale leaves are brown and simple. Vascular bundles in stem are arranged in a ring and show secondary growth. Now, these gymnosperms bear cones, which are usually unisexual, that is either male cone or female cone. Pollen grains are haploid, produced in microsporangia of the male cones. In pinus, each pollen grain has two large sacs called wings to help in the dispersal by wind. Pollen grains produce two male gametes. Ovules are not enclosed in ovary but are born naked on leafy megasporophylls of female cone. So the term gymnosperms or the naked seeds come into existence. Ovules are produced side by side inside which female gamete or egg is produced. The female gamete fuses with the male gamete in the ovule. The fertilized ovule then develops into the seed, as in the case of pinus or any other cedar, cedrus, Jupiter, juniperus, redwood. All these are the examples of gymnosperms that exist in our environment. These are the examples of cones of gymnosperms. Now we move on to the next family of the plants, that is your angiospermy. It includes most familiar plants like pea, mangoes, coconut, wheat, and rice that we see around us. It's a typical flowering plant. Seeds are always enclosed in the fruit, which is a mature, fertilized ovary. The angiosperms are divided into two main groups or classes. First is your dicotyledon, as I told you earlier, and the second one is monocotyledon. Dicot plants have two cotyledons in seeds, whereas monocot plants have only one cotyledon within the seeds, and it bears seeds that are enclosed in the fruits. Now we'll discuss some of the families of angiospermy. First, you can go through the picture of angiospermy, which shows a normal grown plant having all the parts, right from the root, tap, shoot to the shoot system. Roots are present inside the soil, whereas the flowering plant and the leaves grow above the soil. Now you can look into the monocot seed as well as dicot seeds. What is the difference between them? In monocot seeds, it has radical, seed coat, epicotyle, hypocotyle, everything. Whereas in your dicot seeds, though they have the same parts, but in two ways they are present inside it. In your monocot and dicot stem, when we compare between these two stems, they have epidermis at the external, epidermis, hypodermis, They are the three layers that are being present, endodermis, whereas in your monocot stem, epidermis, and the second one is termed as hypodermis. After that, there are vascular bundles, and then we have ground tissues. Now we'll discuss about the families that undercome, they are involved in your angiosperm, included in your families of angiosperms. Now we'll discuss one by one the each family. The first family is your Fabaceae family or Papilionaceae. It's a dicotyledonous family. The plant and herbs or shrubs are rarely trees. Flowers are zygomorphic. It means that a flower can be cut into two equal halves only through one radius. Your flowers are bisexual, they are complete. The calyx consists of 5 sepals and these are jointed. Corolla comprises of 5 petals and it is polypetalous. Papilionaceous in shape or butterfly shaped. There is a large petal called standard, 2 smaller ones called as wings, and the 2 interior small cones, 1 or less jointed, forming the keel. Androecium has 10 stamens arranged in 2 whorls, and your arrangement criteria is 9+1. That is, it is diadelphous, having its stamen fused together at least partly by the filament condition. Gynoecium is superior, it's monocarpellary, that is, it consists of single carpel, unilocular, it means it has a single chamber with many ovules arranged on a marginal placenta. Some examples of the family Fabaceae is pea, groundnut, soya bean, lentils, chickpea, green gram, etc. Now we will discuss about another dicot family, that is Malvaceae. The plants may be herbs, shrubs or trees. Flowers are pentamerous, that is, all whorls have members that are 5 or multiples of 5. And your flowers are actinomorphic, means that it can be divided into 2 equal halves through any radius. Epicalyx is present as an additional whorl of bracteole just below the calyx. Calyx has 5 sepals that may be free or joined at the base. Corolla has 5 petals and they are usually free. The male part, androecium, consists of indefinite numbers of monodelphous stamens. The lower parts or filaments join together to form a staminal tube. Gynoecium consists of 5 carpels. Its ovary is syncarpous as well as superior. It's pentalocular, having exiled placenta. Fruit is a capsule. Some of the examples of plants belonging to family Malvaceae is hibiscus, or in Hindi you call it as gudhal. Then we have cotton, ladyfinger, etc. Now the third family that we will discuss is your Liliaceae family. It's a monocot family. These are mostly perennial herbs. The stem is a rhizome or bulb-like structure. Leaves may be fleshy, colleen, that is around rising from the underground stem. Flowers are bisexual, again actinomorphic, mostly trimerous. Trimerous means that all the whorls have either 3 units or multiples of 3. And your flowers are hypogynous. Perianth is a large petiole, means corolla alike, usually 6, arranged in 2 whorls of 3 each, free and united. Stamens usually 6, that is in the combination of 3+3 in 2 whorls, situated opposite to the perianth lobes. Carpels are 3 in number. It's a syncarpus, means carpels are fused together by their styles or stigmas, but possess different ovaries. Ovary is superior, placentation is exile, and that this is that type of placentation in which carpels are folded inwards with ovules packed inside along the central axis of ovary. Fruit is usually a capsule. Some of the examples of this are shatavar or satmuli, you call it, tulip, kalihari, lily, onion, ghritkumari. The next family that we are going to discuss is another cotyledonous, monocotyledonous family or herbs, that is your family Poaceae. Family Poaceae is a monocotyledonous family. The plants are herbs or rarely woody, as in the case of sugarcane. It's a spike of spikelets, for example, wheat. A small spikelet may contain not more than 5 flowers. Flowers are very small, inconspicuous with scale-like structures. Stamens are 3, sometimes 6 as in the case of rice and bamboo. 3 carpels are present in it. Its syncarpous unilocular ovary, superior bearing a single basal ovule. Fruit is karyopsis, that is, the seed coat and ovary wall are inseparably fused. Some examples of this family are rice, wheat, maize, sugarcane, sarkanda, barley, etc. Thank you.